Welcome to 558 Parkside Tech, where we talk about everything tech, from coding to design, from the past, the present, and the future of tech. Our goal is to educate the culture. I'm your tech plug, Mike. Let's get it right after the jump.
Yeah, 558 Parkside Tech, in effect, that tech, 558 Parkside Tech, in effect, tap in the future, let me introduce ya, 558 Parkside Tech, about to school ya, 558 Parkside Tech, in effect, that 558 Parkside Tech, in effect, that 558 Parkside Tech, in effect, that
Parkside. This is part three and the final part of the fourth industrial revolution. You know, in our previous, we talked a little bit about coding and not everybody should code. We also talked about that there were other jobs in tech. Today, we're going to cover that a little bit more in depth. We're going to talk a little about the history of some of these languages and when they started and then what else was going on at that time, as well as where are the jobs. So let's get into it. You know, in part two of the fourth industrial revolution, we talked about coding and the front end and back end. And really, when you talk to a lot of tech folks, they will say client side, which is the front end languages. You know, that covers JavaScript, HTML, Knockout JS, React, Angular, and so forth. And then we have the server side, which we call back end languages, which will cover your C sharps, your Javas, your Pythons, your C++, your Object-C if you're dealing with Apple. And so when you first jump in, many people don't know where to start. Well, now you have a starting point. If you want to do front-end languages, if you want to code, then you know what languages you need to tackle. If you want to do back-end languages, now you know what languages you need to tackle. You're kind of getting your arms around some of these object-oriented languages in the back, okay? Now, in 1995, when everybody was dancing and having a good time, and the movie, I think it was called Dangerous Minds, was out, everybody was listening to Coolio's Gangsta Paradise. But at the same time, there was another gangster running around. His name was Brendan Eich, who created JavaScript in 1995. And he really created it for a browser that no longer exists. It was called Netscape. So all the old school heads will probably know Netscape, if you're familiar with that. It's no longer around, and it was for the front end. And so that's why you notice that a lot of your Knockout, React, all those have JS on the end, because all those do some flavor of JavaScript. Even if you have TypeScript, if you're learning that, you will find that after you write in TypeScript, it'll create a .js file, a JavaScript file. So his influence into the market and what we have in our front end was very important. Now, at the same time that was happening in 1995, you can see that was a crazy year. A guy named James Gosling created Java, which is the backend language for Sun Microsystem. And as you can see, that language is still around. That's a pretty strong object-oriented language that many people are using now, along with C#. Now, in 2001, 6 years later, when we were dancing to So Fresh and So Clean, and Outkast was doing their thing, there was another guy, Anders Isberg, who created C# in 2001, and he created it for Microsoft. I probably murdered his name, but he was the one that was instrumental in giving Microsoft its start as far as its backend languages are concerned. Now, in order to build this front end and back end, you had to have some way in which you do it, some organized way when you meet how you're going to go about building these languages, whether it be front end or back end. So many people use Waterfall at the time. This is prior to 2001. And Waterfall had a set of requirements that you had to do before you start building anything. You know, you had to have a planning meeting. What are we going to design? What kind of screen is it going to look like? You had requirements that all the department heads would have to sign off on. Then you would do some analysis, you would do some design, and you'd bring it back to the people who wanted it and say, is this what you really wanted? And then you go off and you code. And then you would do testing and you would deploy it into the world, you know? But many companies prior to 2001 felt that this took too long. Other people are beating us to market because our process is taking too long. So of course, you know, necessity is the mother of invention. So a bunch of guys, 17, it's interesting it's all guys though, but a bunch of guys, 17, went to Utah up with an idea, and they worked on coming up with something that would make developers and organizations design applications faster and have them out to market. Right? And it was called the Agile Manifesto in 2001. And since then, most people have been using the Agile Manifesto. If you work in a company, pretty much if they got a tech division, they're using Agile. So if you're starting in tech, just know when you finish whatever course you're finishing, and if you were to get a job as an intern or a junior developer or whatever, you're probably going to be thrown into some kind of Agile methodology. And Agile just kind of stripped away some of the requirements, gathering some of the documentation. It just speeded along the process where you met every day for, you know, 5 minutes or 10 minutes and decide what you're going to do for the day, and you got things done a little quicker. That doesn't mean always the applications were better, but they were faster. I'll leave it at that. So now if we go looking for a job in Agile, you'll find that there are 187,000 jobs dealing with the word Agile. Because most companies or shops, IT shops, are using Agile methodology. So you're going to find that across the board. Now, if you're a business analyst, then your job is to keep this Agile afloat and keep it and making sure everything is enforced as far as requirements gathering, as far as having stand-ups and scrums, which we'll talk about Agile and the steps you have to do later in another episode. But if you look here, there are over 40,000 jobs just dealing in, as a business analyst, dealing with Agile. Also, if you didn't want to code, and so you could see you could be a business analyst here, you could be a tester. There are over 27,000 jobs as I look out here in Indeed, Monster, and Glassdoor, the search engines for looking for a job. There were 27,000 jobs just for testers alone. Now, of course, if you didn't want to code once again, and you didn't want to be a tester, you didn't want to be a business analyst, there's networking. That is the thing that connects that front end to that back end. So that person who's writing that front end screen or that client side screen, it has to connect to the back end somehow, and it has to be secure. And so there's a network team that kind of handles that. And there were over 23,000 jobs just dealing in networking as of November 2021. Well, if you didn't want to do networking, you didn't want to be a tester, you didn't want to be a business analyst, you could also be a database administrator or deal with the database. There, Microsoft has SQL Server, which I've searched here, which has 48,000 jobs just there. But you also have other ones like Postgres. You have NoSQL Database, which is also a Microsoft tool. So there are many jobs that are not coding. And they're out there. You just have to figure out which one you want. And that's the whole point of this conversation, is to let you know there are other avenues, not just that one avenue. Now here for coding in C Sharp, there are 86,000 jobs. So there's so many avenues that the coder can jump into. They don't have to just code. They can test. They could do networking. There are many avenues that you could possibly take. Now, I'm going to talk about something that happened back in the day. See, in 1959, a woman named Grace Harper, who they say came up with the term bug, because there was a moth that kind of flew into one of her relays, which was causing her program not to work. And when she found that it was an actual, because it was a moth, she called it a bug. And that term has been used to this day, that there's a bug in your logic if something's not right. So in 1959, she helped create this COBOL language, and COBOL is an acronym for Common Business Oriented Language, and it was used by IBM. And to this day, that language is still being used, and a lot of these newer languages, like in 1995, Java, and in C-Sharp in 2001, you can see that 1959 was a pivotal year for even those languages coming about. They all took from each other, so to speak. Now, Grace Harper had such a strong influence. Even today, there's a Grace Harper convention that happens every single year to celebrate women in tech. And so, in that particular conference, there's a lot of hiring that takes place. There's a lot of networking that takes place among women. So now, if you were to go to Indeed and you type in the word COBOL, there are over 2,000 jobs. just in COBOL. So it's still around. A lot of your major corporations, huge, that have been around a long time, your power companies, your government that houses a lot of data, they didn't all convert from mainframe to web applications like, you know, Java and C Sharp. They didn't change their language, you know, or translate from COBOL to those other languages. So those, they call those legacy systems. Those legacy systems still exist. And there are still jobs out there for those that work in cities or in government. They will still be probably writing in COBOL, writing in some .NET, some OOP languages or object-oriented languages, but mainly COBOL. And as you can see, even on the mainframe, they had a quasi front end. That front end was called CICS. So that was that green screen. If you're old enough to remember, or you're young enough to go to work and your mom and them was working, they had a screen and it had green letters on it. And that was CICS. And that was kind of their front end. And that's what people would enter data. It's the same way you do on your phone right now. Okay, and that's your front end screen. Okay, and in the back end, COBOL would run. Okay, and COBOL was interacting when they were running batch jobs. They were interacting with JCL, which was OS JCL. And we'll talk about that in another episode, because I'm going to walk through COBOL OS JCL as well. I'm going to try to give you both sides, from the .NET side or the web application side, which is Java and C Sharp, and those languages all the way to the back end. Now, when I say mainframe, what do I mean? If you can picture your PC, but bigger. So it's one main processor that's connected to a lot of servers. So your CICS and your COBOL would be on these servers, and the main processor would be your mainframe. And it's called a mainframe. That's a generic term, but it actually has like a series name. Like in this case, it would be the Z series. And it also interacts with the web applications as well. So don't think this is a standalone thing and it does nothing. Mainframe has evolved as well. And also they have cloud. IBM has the cloud. IBM has Linux that connects to it as well and does SOAP. But those are conversations we'll have in another setting. The whole goal of this meeting is just to kind of, you know, outline for you that there are other jobs in tech, not just coding. But if you do get involved with coding, the different avenues you can take as well. So now, to end this, we've kind of, to end this series, this three-part series, in this particular one, we've talked about the Agile methodology that's currently being used since 2001. We also talk about the different jobs that are in tech that you can get involved in. It's not just coding, but if you do get involved with coding, that you understand that you could do front-end, you could do back-end, you could do networking, you can also do testing, you can be a business analyst, you can go get an Agile certification and just do that. Okay, so that's what this whole thing was about. Now, no, it's not going to be easy. But the one thing I've learned along the way in tech is just know that today you learned more than you learned yesterday. And the next day, go learn something else. And never look up to see how much you have to learn, because you'll probably get yourself, make yourself dizzy. So just realize, just go step by step in tech.
Thank you for joining us today. And if you enjoyed the content, please subscribe or press the like button. Or join us at 558parksidetech.com. And remember, program or be programmed. And be greater than your greatest excuse and learn tech. Because life and tech waits for no one. Peace.
Tap in the future, let me introduce ya. 558 Parkside Tech, bout to school ya. 558 Parkside Tech, in effect, 558 Parkside Tech, in effect, 558 Parkside Tech, in effect, 558 Parkside Tech, in effect.